Take Five. So what happened after the 2008 financial crisis? How did the international community of various regulators, supervisors, the international bodies that are setting standard rules for the financial markets, political class, how did all these parties react? Well, in many ways, but in the following 10 minutes or so, we will focus on the Financial Stability Board. And this body was created in 2009, and it's established in Basel in Switzerland. And basically, it's a creation of the G20 countries that in a meeting decided that this board will oversight and will promote reform on an international level and in a way a coordinator among various parties that are interested and involved in such a process, like the central banks in all the G20 countries, ministries of finance, and also other sorts of international bodies like European Central Bank, European Commission, and the Basel Committee for Bank Supervision. Such a committee being the central part of the Basel III rules, about which we will talk in another separate video. Now, from the website of the Financial Stability Board, I took this three-stage process that mainly describes the work of such a body. So they are trying, in the first place, to identify the systemic risk in the financial sector. And again, we are talking internationally, so they try to have a global view. Then they are framing the policy actions that could or hopefully address such identified risks. And they are doing this through consultations with all the countries. Then they are involving the players in the real market, and they are taking their input. So it's a fairly long process. And after that, after they reach a certain policy, they try to oversee the implementation of such policies at the level of each country. Very important, the rules that are being issued in this process are not mandatory for the country, so each country is free to sanction them and apply them into their own laws. But it is not mandatory. Nevertheless, being endorsed by the political will of the G20 countries, it's still a power behind this, the international rules, why once they are decided. Let's move a little bit forward and look at the initial objectives of the Financial Stability Board. And there are four main categories in which they try to rule. And these are to solve the problem of too big to fail, to solve the insufficient capitalization of the banks in particular, being identified as an issue in the financial crisis that the banks weren't able to ensure enough capital, enough equity to face the downturn and not such friendly conditions. And then in the derivatives sector, which of course is blamed by many for contributing to the financial crisis. And in this sector, they try to make things more transparent and sort of pushing the transaction and the clearing of standardized derivatives from the over-the-counter market to specialized trading platforms or exchanges, and the clearing of these transactions to be made through central clearing houses. An important step towards this more transparent market in derivatives was the reporting of data about the transactions in the over-the-counter derivatives, and what kind of data should be reported to whom, and more importantly, who is going to have access to this data about the transactions that were made in the derivative market. So it's a pretty big task. And let's see then 10 years after the crisis, what really happened. And I took this from the latest report of the Financial Stability Board, which can be found in on their website, and it's very instructive. It's not long, and it has a high-level global view. So I would recommend reading it. So of course they are trying to promote their doings and their role, and to put things in a favorable light. But nevertheless, they are reporting that on these four main areas, now the large banks are better capitalized, and data are being shown and given. And basically this bank capitalization, banks leverage ratios and liquidity ratios are all part of the Basel III standards, about which we will discuss in a separate video. But on this aspect, probably the progress is obvious for everybody, and nobody is contesting it. Not necessarily, or not only, because of the effort to regulate this microprudential financial indicators like capital ratios, leverage ratio, liquidity ratios, but also because the banks itself recognize that there is a need for such a better capitalization going through the experience of the financial crisis the way they did. And mostly they increase their capital, basically the equity, through retained earnings. Then in what respect of the so-called too big to fail, the report is saying that the reforms is advancing, but we will see in a later slide, the too big to fail share of financial assets actually increased. So it's probably under the wording that reforms is advancing, the general wording is covering not such a good actual progress. But they establish some effective resolutions, rules for banks. And what does it mean? It means that it's like the will of the banks, that the banks were asked, mandated to create, in which they have to have contingencies, plans, or a very well-established plan of what's happening in case of insolvency. Then, over-the-counter OTC derivatives markets, the report is saying that they became more simpler and more transparent. And also that there are more and more derivatives that are being centrally cleared. Well, especially in the forex market and the interest rate swaps. This, of course, is debatable, but indeed, reading throughout the time in the press, there is also this idea that indeed, not only because of the regulation, but many players in these markets prefer to transact over the exchanges and to clear centrally, because as long as the product is standardized, because the markets are more liquid, but and of course the counterparty risk is much reduced because of the central clearing. But it is sad, and also the report is recognizing this, that it's working for major players and is discouraging smaller players to transact in this in such a way and use exchanges then, because the costs are discouraging. Then another aspect that is that basically was the core of the financial crisis, the so-called shadow banking, and whatever it represents. Right now, the report is not calling the sector shadow banking anymore, but non-bank financial institutions and their activity intermediation. And the report is saying that this sector, so the shadow banking, actually increased since the financial crisis. But because it is not involved any longer in the activities that were considered the cause of the crisis, like securitization and structured finance and asset-backed commercial paper transacted via structured vehicles, these activities were reduced a lot. So from this perspective, the shadow banking system, it is considered of not posing financial stability risk, at least for now. But nevertheless, it is noted that it increased since the financial crisis. I was going to say since the revolution. Okay, so here we have some graphs taken from the very same report that is showing that indeed the global economy is recovering from the effects of the financial crisis, but at the expense of a higher public debt ratio in all the advanced economies, being considered as a legacy of the financial crisis. So again, the report is saying, or the Financial Stability Board view is that all these reforms were performed and imposed on the countries, but they didn't affect the lending capacity of the players that had to accommodate such rules and obey, but on contrary, the lending to non-financial firms and households has increased since the financial crisis, and the cost of lending remained low. And of course, this is one of the explanations can be very well the accommodative monetary policy, with interest rate being kept at zero levels or even negative levels for so many years, for the entire period actually since the financial crisis. And that growth that indeed varies across the regions around the world, so it's being registered less growth in the advanced economies versus the emerging economies. But they are saying that there is no sign, whatever science might mean in this case, that the reforms have led to a shortage in the supply of financing. But again, the report notes that it was registered as a shift from the banks lending towards the shadow banking type of lending through the non-bank financial institutions that are taking many forms. And indeed, especially in China, where this sector grew a lot lately. And of course, these positive results were registered, but risk keep evolving. You regulate a part of the market and the risk is moving maybe elsewhere. So after a decade of very low interest rates, financial institutions and markets may not be sufficiently prepared for adverse developments. This is a theme, and we saw that the markets are so sensitive on the announcement of increasing interest rates, for example, by the Fed. then, again, another subject that it's very much on focus is the high sovereign corporate and household debt levels that that basically increased in this period. And sharply rising yields could trigger swings in cross-border capital flows. And we saw that happen in the European sovereign debt crisis. So after years of borrowing by the countries, when the financial crisis came, all the capital that used to flow in those countries from the European peripheries, actually stopped and moved from those countries. of course, we have problems with implementing the rules that maybe the most active actors in this sector are imposing or creating. So six European countries, the biggest ones, that are part of this Financial Stability Board exercise and representing 30% of the market, like it's in this category, it's France, it's Germany, it's Spain, is Netherlands. So basically these European countries, part of the Basel Committee and part of G20, are not compliant with the Basel III capital requirements. So even after, even if Basel started to Basel 2.5 after the financial crisis started to be implemented in 2010, and still there are problems in these European countries. And as we discussed, the share of global systemically important banks, so the too big to fail, now are a bigger share than before the crisis. And here we have a graph showing this. Well, this was about the Financial Stability Board, and now the theory is moving a little bit around the role of a central bank. So what should a central bank do in our times after the financial crisis? And it is noted that the traditional role of the central bank in general, not only of the Fed, they were concerned with the monetary policy and keeping inflation at bay. And also some of them, central banks or other regulators depends on the country. They were involved in micro-prudential supervision, concerned with the soundness of individual financial institutions, like these capital ratios and leverage liquidity ratios that Basel III are dealing with, and which are applied individually to each bank. But the global financial crisis and the euro sovereign crisis for that matter show that even if every actor in these markets is well capitalized, regulated, or perfect, the system as a whole may pose a systemic risk, and then it doesn't matter what each individual player is doing, it's a macroprudential problem. So the role of the central banks are being expanded in this area that is being called macroprudential supervision. And basically, the macroprudential supervision is trying to ensure the stability of the financial system as a whole. And we remember from the initial mandate of the Fed when it was established in 1913, that actually this was the primary, the main mandate of the Fed to ensure the financial stability. So in a way, the role of the central banks are moved back to this goal. So a little bit of more details about what macroprudentialism mean and how it relates to the traditional tools of monetary policy. And we can see here on the graph that basically monetary policy is dealing with the short-term interest rate, trying to ensure price stability. And of course, the ultimate goal being a stable and non-inflationary growth in the economy, while macroprudential rules are dealing with counter-cyclical buffers, so trying to protect the entire economy from the downturns, so not everything bad to happen in the same time, the goal being the same, to ensure the financial stability of the entire system and let everybody grow without problems. So based on these new concepts, new theories, then various central banks in the world gain more powers in these macroprudential dimensions. And here we have some examples from the European Central Bank that right now is running also the single supervisory mechanism in Europe. So it has a direct influence on some banks or holdings that are considered too big to fail and considered to pose a systemic risk for the entire economy. Also, the Bank of England gained more powers, the Federal Reserve System. And of course, we talked about this Financial Stability Board that is trying to coordinate all the actions, including in these areas that are being taken by each country and their regulatory bodies. But of course, these are new concepts. For the time being, there was no financial crisis to test this new theories and the rules that were born out of it. So this was the first part, the first video, And in another two videos, we will talk about the Basel Committee for Banking Supervision, Basel III rules, and also about a little bit about Dodd-Frank Act, and maybe more about the Fed's new roles in the macroprudential supervision. Thank you.